going to dedicate this to all the people who worked our record and just bigged us up. So
who
thank you. Mad respect. Just thank you. Yo, bust it. Here we go. Strumming my pain with his fingers. Singing my life with his words. Killing me softly with his sword. Killing me softly with his song. Telling my whole life with his words. Killing me softly with his song. Yo, yo, I heard he sang a good song.
Yeah.
I heard he had a style.
It all started with me. I met Lauren in high school. I was a senior. I think she was either freshman or coming in as a freshman.
Real story is, you know what I'm saying, he was like the big man, you know what I'm saying, in the high school. He wanted to put two cute girls in a group behind him, you know what I'm saying, so he could look like the man, the player of the high school. So it was me and this other girl named Marcy, and you know, we used to sing background, and he used to rap, you know, basically boost up his ego, you know. And then one day Wyclef comes to the studio to meet the girls. And he comes and starts showing off on the mic.
Can I get a beat, man? Purple rain, purple rain.
One day Wyclef came to the studio, he was vibing, he dropped some vocals, and then I guess the rest is history.
I had on my Bobby Brown suit, you know, with my my boots. What kind of boots were those?
Patent leather boots.
I had my patent leather boots, you know.
With a yacht hat.
The Melly Mel days. I was a cross between Melly Mel and Jimmy Cliff. And I was like, yo, Prize, come here. I said, yo, who that girl in the booth singing? He was like, yo, man, you can't talk to her, man. She's too young for you. Not only that, you know, her brother, he trusts me. Where's Bond, Cliff? I know you, man. I said, nah, I'm chilling, man. So then I went in the booth, and I was like, two girls, I'm about to blow up this spot. I do what I do best, which is show off.
You are not alone. On the microphone.
They just couldn't stop laughing. They was just like laughing, and then I was like, yo, Prize, count me in. And I went back to my other group with a big smile.
We were like, yo, let's use Refugees. And we took the re out, kept Fugees, and that's how it became. Like Refugees in the sense of like seeking refuge through our music.
Every author writes his story however he chooses, you know. He writes his book how he sees it. So all we did was, we just wrote the book the way we saw it, you know. Because we talked about the streets and the guns and the police brutality and the drug dealers and the everything, because it's an everyday life, you know, from you know, close friends to family, you know, it's like real to us. It's a reality. People being locked up, that's a reality. Behind bars is a reality. Guns is a reality. So we felt that we could talk about it, but in a way that was real to us.
Yo, yes, yes. We bring you a message from the projects around the whole world. We don't know how it is out here, but police brutality needs to fucking stop.
I don't remember my life without rap music. I don't remember being born into a world without rap. My grandma had 13 children, so the youngest uncles and the youngest, you know, cousins were like my age, but the older version. So they got to go to like the Roxy and Latin Quarter, so they would always tell me about Melly Mel and Grandmaster Flash.
The Grandmaster Flash, the Run DMCs in the early 82s, 83s. You know, if you got a love for it, you just naturally get into it, but it's a culture, you know. Some just walk alongside of it, some are just in it, you know.
We are really hip-hoppers, straight up and down. We're hip-hop. A lot of times you have a lot of bands who are musicians or jazz musicians or R&B musicians with a hip-hop influence. But we happen to be hip-hop influence or hip-hoppers with all these other influences, you know, within us. So it comes out in this hip-hop format. I'll always have drums that are like, you know, that boom, boom, tap, that hip-hop rhythm.
If you listen to hip-hop, you have all styles of music.
Part of that's because they sample, you know what I mean?
Because I mean, you get from like, you know, jazz, you get...
You can borrow from wherever.
You know, and a lot, you know, the kids, that's what they love. They love hip-hop. Yeah.
If I never got a deal, if I wasn't in this position now, it didn't mind to me. It was about, you know, us being able to do what we were able to do, you know, singing and laughing and dancing. It was so much fun back then.
Blunted on Reality, it was like, I call it like the genesis, just to start the development of something, you know. It's like in the beginning, and then you're waiting to see what's going on.
You wanna flip a little something in crayon. Souviens oreilles tendez, souviens bouche parler, si et pas ça, pays en libre coulé.
Luckily, God has given me a gift, you know. I play like close to 7 different instruments. I think a little more. And the gift started off when I was in the church, actually. I came from Haiti and my father got a church in Brooklyn. But as you all know, you know, when you start off in a church, it's usually, you don't just start off with a big congregation. It's usually, the church was my mother, my father, and my sisters, and my brothers. So we were the congregation, and it was my pop's church. So we had to play instruments. But of course, at the time, we couldn't really afford, you know, like real equipped, you know, sufficient instruments. So the first instrument I got, because I couldn't afford an organ or a piano, was an accordion. So on Sunday morning, you would hear, oh, amazing, and I'm like, wah, 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 you know, and all of this is like off key. I don't know what the hell I'm doing.
See, you know what? A long time ago when I was much younger, Clef tried to teach me, but he's a very evil, wicked guitar teacher, yo. Anybody who wants lessons, don't take them from Clef. My fingernails would grow too long, he would bite them off and spit them out and smack my hand. He's just very mean, but he's very talented, he's gifted. So now I'm taking a slow route and I'm trying to learn by myself and pick. But if it wasn't for my singing, you know what I mean, if it wasn't for the fact that I sing with it, then I probably wouldn't be any good because I can't really play. I just write songs and I have about 300 songs with the exact same chords.
The way I develop my ear is like, them church people, a lot of them used to sing off-key. You know, like if they sing an Amazing Grace, they go, Amazing Grace, how sweet that. And you know, you're like, is there a note that goes with this?
I mean, music, like it's like you have 3 different styles here. You know, if I was to do it myself, I'd probably do something totally different. If she was to do it herself, she'd probably do it totally different. Him, he'd probably do it totally different. But the fusion of the 3 gives a unique, you know? It's like 3 different, I mean, it's always arguments, you know, but if it's the vibe, it's the vibe, you know?
We learn a lot from each other, mistakes, you know? It's like a team. Prize made sure he handled the loot. Production, production.
I knew I couldn't handle money, so I said, yo, deal with that.
That's my niche, and you know, it's like a lot of groups either have just the artistic and that's it, you know. Like I said, the success of Fuji has to do with a whole bunch of different elements, you know, and every one plays an important role, you know. So with the Fugees, you have Wyclef, like really the brain behind the music, you know. You got me, the brain behind the business, and you got Lauren, she's in between the two, you know. So, but it's like, it keeps it balanced, you know. So it's like our business is being taken care of as well as the music, you know. It's not just, I mean, I've seen a lot of groups who sold millions of records and don't have anything to show for it, you know.
Praz is a person who, he gets into the whole business thing, you know. He really, if you see, watch him walk down the stairs and the phone will be attached. He really gets into that. That's his shelter. Clef is a music person. If he could live inside a guitar case, he would do that, because that's him. Me, I'm in the middle of those two worlds, you know. But at the same time, I think I find shelter in the things that I like to do for, like, the community. Like, I want to open up a youth center. That's, like, the bomb place. It's, like, almost as fun as a club, you know, any club or any street corner. But just that promotes, like, unconditional love and, like, empowerment.
Actually, the Booger Basement, I be hearing a lot of people write different stories, you know, and none of them are right. The true story is, my cousin, his name was Rennell Duplessis, he bought a little six-track. You know, she called it a karaoke machine, but it wasn't that. It was a little six-track machine, and he called me up, and he was like, yo, I got something for you. So I was mad excited. Went over there, and he was like, yo. So I seen it. It was a six-track. I was like, perfect. Hooked up some keyboards, Junos, and whatever. Then a week later, I found myself just making phone calls, boom, boom, boom. Or like when I get calls, I just naturally would be like, studio, you know, studio. One day, Elle came over, you know, she couldn't stop laughing, you know, talking about my joint was a karaoke machine.
Yeah, but.
And I only had one mic.
I stayed there, though.
So then.
I spent enough time in the karaoke basement.
So.
This was before, like, you know how.
It wasn't even a basement.
You know how a sound booth. It's supposed to have like glass so that you can't hear the vocals, you know what I'm saying? The music can't flood into the vocal room. This is before we had any glass. So he'd be like, yo, do it again. He would just shout it out to us. Yo, sing it one more time. And so you'd hear like his orders and everything on the records. But it was
so it was pretty ghetto. And
it was
from
dope.
There we developed just
like
the
that.
Sense of
a ear.
Yeah.
Definitely an ear.
Yes. For studio, definitely, we started developing the ear. But, you know, we developed that, you know, it don't really matter. You could be at the biggest studio. It's not really about where you at. It's about the vibe.
Can I just tell the people how they used to finance the studio?
Go ahead.
Y'all didn't used to sell the same tracks to different people.
No, we ain't do that, yo. We ain't never do that.
I'm playing. Cut that part out. I'm just playing. I'm playing.
Nah, yo, don't play us out like that. What we used to do is we used to actually change the tracks up a little and sell them to the same people. Nah, but, you know, from there we developed that it wasn't a big studio, a 48 track, but it's just about the vibe. Once you catch the vibe, you record it. And then naturally, whatever comes out of you, that's really what the people look for. And we're blunted on reality, you know, which was produced by like Khalees Bayan from Kool & the Gang, like a father figure to us in the music industry, you know what I'm saying? He definitely looked out for us and told us everything that was gonna happen or a lot of the things we might not do them like we do them today, you know?
This is where it all started. Like this is a, you know, this is a little advanced. I mean, for those who really know, this ain't really advanced, but it's advanced compared to where we started. I remember we had a four-track machine, you know. We built up to this, you know.
As it goes on, it's developing. So by the time the score came, we was just developing, and, you know, we knew what we wanted to do, so we did that with the score.
The score was produced by mostly me and Lauren. So I knew the sound was going to change completely because now I got a chance to put what I want to put in as a producer. And I figured that it would be my sound. You know, it would be the Fugees sound. So I know there would be more acoustic guitar. I knew the tracks would be more mellow. I know even if they were amped, there would be more feeling. And then the Fugees can express what we call ghetto talent, which means you can sing and it still remains raw to the streets, which was hard for a lot of groups. A lot of kids were coming out, rah, 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 then they disappear.
See, the thing is, a lot of people have successful records because it's a fad or it's a trend, but no one have records where people feel your vibe, you know, people get something out of it. And that's the most satisfaction for us, is the fact that you touch someone, you know? I know people who sell millions of records, but it's because at that time it was, everybody jumped on it, it was a trend, it was a fad, but it didn't really affect it. It's like eating Chinese food. You eat all that food, you'd be full for about an hour. After that, you'd be hungry, because it's no substance to it, you know? This has substance, it has elements, it has growth, it has everything in it, you know? That's, to me, the best thing, you know? It's like listening to a Bob Marley record. You know, it's like you get something out of it.
We already had the music, you know, within us. We just didn't know how to put it down. And we didn't necessarily have the money to put it down in the first album. So the second album, we definitely controlled our finances and just controlled our own creativity. So the score is all Fugee, you know, it's all Fugee. And the reality of it is that we're not saying anything different, you know. We're not saying anything really different from the first album to the second. We're just saying it a little differently. The style is a little bit different, so people, you know, can hear it a little bit better.
I mean, once again, three different elements. We used to be number 10. Ooh, la, la, la. I sit 90 degrees on the Nippon trees. And we was like, let's just do a party jam. And then Lauren always goes in the studio and sings 10,000 hooks. And they all sound good. And then we say, yeah, well, which hook do we use? And somehow we always end up, you know. So it was ooh, la, la, la.
It's like
the refugee story in every country. And I mean, even my...
Going through the obstacles.
Yeah, even my uncle could look at it and don't know a thing about the Fugees, but could relate with what's going on. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know, and we
running,
like on some
from
old
oppression.
Feel good yeah. about yourself minority
yeah. and
type.
We're going to make it because at the end we made it.
At the end we're going to make it.
Refugee camp is just, you know, just something that we put together in order to, you know, give kids like us who come from different boroughs, you know, different neighborhoods in New York and New Jersey, a place to come and enjoy some recreation, you know, and also learn something about, you know, about different cultures and, you know, a little bit of educational things, you know, go on here too. But in like a recreational musical sort of theme, you know. There's really nothing difficult about it, you know, nothing profound. It's just us being all around the world and, you know, seeing Germany and France and London and just trying to show some other young people who don't have the opportunities that we have that there's more to life than you know, their borough or five blocks. I received a lot of love, so I'm able to give love, but not a lot of people receive love, so they carry a lot of anger within them. I think for us, you know, even with the music that we do, somehow we end up being like surrogate parents, you know? So we're just doing it, just another way of doing that, you know? It's just something that's extremely important to me. Yeah, the idea was just all about a vibe. You know, it was this song that was taking on these big proportions. We just wanted to bring it back home. And, you know, let the public know what the inspiration was. And we had gone back to this old movie called Coolie High. We wanted to set it in a theater. You know, the community, girls kissing, you know, girls and guys making out, you know, popcorn fights and just the whole old school vibe, you know. Also, we wanted to use it as a tool in the whole concept of bringing all the videos together with the whole score concept because we were sitting in a theater, so we were going to insert pieces in our other videos as us watching ourselves. And the whole object was that we were in the audience watching ourselves on the screen.
So
and that's what the movie was. So,
so
was
all it, along, we've just been watching ourselves.
Watching ourselves.
And at the, you're not really supposed to get it till the end.
Yeah.
When we put the whole home video together. And then
you know, y'all create your magic.
And basically to let people know that, you know what I'm saying, it's no different, that there is no difference with us. We are no different than anybody else, you know, just as we can dress up like cowboys and cowgirls and cowboys, and we can run around the world and be chased and be on MTV and this and that, you know, that we still go to the theater, throw popcorn and kiss our girlfriends and boyfriends, you know what I'm saying? So it was just a very down-to-earth, real, you know, sort of humble video.
The act that you are about to see is one that has definitely been taking the entire world by storm.
You know, it was a good experience being on the road with Donnie Ina and Michael Malden.
Well, we just wanted to tell you, you have the
number one record in America.
It was a good feeling to hear, yo, y'all number one this week, you know?
Yeah.
Refugees up in here. Sony Music Amsterdam one time.
That's right.
El Boogie Proswell, Wyclef. Here we go.
We used to be number 10, now we permanent appointed.
With live performance, it's important that, like, these young kids today, like, they're just growing up right now. And I want them to understand the importance of a drum player, a guitar player, a bass player, like in the days of the James Brown era. I don't want that stuff to be foreign to them. So if they want to pick up an instrument and play it, so they won't be like, oh, the guitar is corny or the piano is corny. Because, I mean, through music, you can express yourself.
It's all right.
It's all right. Yo, I got something special for Amsterdam. Check it out.
Yo, bust it. Here we go. Strumming.
And you see, man, when you go to Europe, bro, then you understand that it's not about black and white.
It's about
that comes to your, you know, like people who really think it's a black and white thing. Let me tell you, if there's people that feel it more than me in the heart. You understand? It's about the heart. You know, if you can get with what I'm doing from your heart, there's no front. You could be a green man. You know what I'm saying? One day I was rocking and the alien popped up. You know what I'm saying?
I remember that show.
The alien was digging me. And then I turned around, started freestyling
for the
alien.
What you said? You said, yo, where's Brooklyn at? And the alien raised his hand.
Yo, don't play me out. You know I seen the alien.
Are you dead,
Pride.
Yo?
Yeah.
He was from the planet of Brooklyn.
Yeah, man.
No, for real, though. On the real, I seen a mermaid, though.
Oh, don't go into this story. He just told us this story the other day.
L.
See, our music touched everybody.
Listen,
fish.
I'm going to tell you this story. Because, I'm from Haiti.
Now, mind you.
You know
what I'm saying? He left Haiti when he was 7 years old, right?
No, I didn't leave when I was
Okay, how old were you?
I was 8.
Okay, my bad. I'm sorry. 8. Okay, so when you're 8 years old, you know, like, you remember things. Like, I remember my grandmother's house being 20 times bigger than it was. But go ahead.
We was in the backyard, you know, and then where we lived, they had the beach. You know what I'm saying? In the back. And then I was just sitting, because I was always a kid that was just weird, you know? So I was just to myself in the back, just kicking up. And then I seen this lady. You know, and then I just seen the face, so I thought it was somebody like in the water, like, you know, like swimming.
Yeah.
And she was like, hey, little boy.
No, hey, little fella. That's what she said.
No, but I'm saying boy, fella, it's the same thing. Don't play me
that's
out.
Just, I'm just she, trying she to get
said it in Creole.
I'm just trying to get a word for word.
If I said in Creole, y'all ain't going to understand.
Right,
so
man,
she didn't
ahead,
say
man.
Hey, little fella.
She was a Haitian mermaid.
She was a Haitian mermaid. Yo, why you playing me
I'm off? Saying.
I ain't telling the story.
No,
yo,
tell
I'm
a story. Come on, man. I'm just playing.
Yo, I'm done, man.
Tell a story.
Nah, man. You just played me out. The Haitian
mermaid. I'm saying.
That's like,
it's important
yo,
that we put that. That's a piece
I'm
of
done,
information
yo.
That
I'm
needs
done,
to be
man.
In the story. Go ahead.
And you know what? If this mermaid is watching this, I want you to come get her, yo. Don't go to the sea, yo.
Ready or not, here I come.
Ready or not for us was 3 days in the military. What do you call it? 3 days in the military, man. And it was definitely an experience because at the very last minute, one of us copped out and I had to suffer. I want the world to know that I had to suffer as a non-swimmer. I want the world to know I don't swim.
But you know what really is the bugged out thing? Is that people look at videos and they look all polished. Man, let me tell you, what you go through to create something that's only, what, 3 minutes and 30 seconds long?
And that's not three standing days. On the block, yo.
Oh, man, yo. Every video from now on is going to be on my mother's porch. That's going to be my spot. I'm going to be like, just get me right here on the steps. Because we went cold water. We had rain, thunderstorms. There's one point, Proz was just drooling. He couldn't even control himself no more. Spit was just coming out his mouth.
Yeah. Especially like the submarine.
Oh, the rain scenes was the worst.
As much as it looked fun at the end of that video,
when we were waving, smiling
at the submarine. Ooh, that was cold below zero water pouring on us. A team plays the game.
Baseball.
And when they play to win. But they play as a team. So when we did the album, we did it as a team, you know? So as a team, we did an album that we thought was gonna sell like 500,000 as a team. But as a team, he said, I remember from his mouth.
What did you say?
He predicted 5 million.
Really?
Yeah. You don't expect that, you know? But what you do is, we just do music and don't think about it. Like people, they say, how many songs you got for your album? I got 100 joints ready to go now.
I got 6 points.
So it's not a matter of that. We do the music
every day.
And somehow from the littlest kid to the oldest person, they feel good about it. So then we stand back and say, you know what? We're just like, we're being used as vessels.
To communicate, that's right.
To communicate. Something. So. We give all the thanks to the man upstairs.
Yo, Steve Marley, throw in your father's old record.
Yeah. I did a song with Steve Marley, and it was definitely an experience for me. We did a version of No Woman, No Cry. And what I did is I had a camera crew come and film it in the studio while we were recording because the vibe was so strong. For the first time, something happened there that never happened. The vibe was so strong. That
after we recorded the song,
we were supposed to mix it, but that from like five blocks down, a block out just hit everything and everything turned off and we had to stop, you know. So it was definitely an experience and we was catching that. And you know what was weird about that? Blackout didn't come till it was time to mix. And then it was just a block out and it was like, yo, y'all can't mix here basically. So, the vibe was definitely strong up at the studio we was at. So we left. And you know, the important thing with what you know, I was trying to capture in the piece was, you know, me growing up listening to Marley, and I respect his music very much. And it's the same way if I had kids, you know? And, you know, the way me and Steve, you know, clicked was like two brothers just meeting, and it was just a natural vibe. And it was a lot of love there, so we recorded it with a lot of love. You know, Lauren singing with the Marley sisters. It was just one big
happy family.
And when you hear that, you say, yo, like Marley, the whole vibe just live on.
You know what's funny? You know that was divine, too, because for a long time, people had been telling us that they were going to link us up with the Marleys and stuff. It just so happened that we linked ourselves up.
Yeah, and it's
you know,
just
and it happened naturally. Nobody tried to, you know. Hey, I did your pop song. It was just like, you know.
Yeah, we met.
It just happened.
And then we definitely kicked it off.
Yeah, it was nothing but love, yo. Nothing but love.